Institute and organised in cooperation with the Ayn Rand Centre. Both of these organisations are actually donor funded, and we wouldn't have this event today if it wasn't for them, so a thank you to them. And it's with this that we can start the discussion.
So,
one, two.
Any way to get some water up here? So that would be great. Water?
Sorry, I didn't think to bring one.
Yeah. Okay.
We didn't think it would be such a secure facility.
Yeah, it really is. There's
time
here.
Any
man will do it.
Sorry.
No, I mean, there isn't. I'm just curious before we get started. How many of you have read Ayn Rand? Okay, how many of you have heard of Ayn Rand? Okay. Couple haven't heard or read Ayn Rand, all right, so we can change that today. That's good. No, I mean, Ayn Rand was an absolutist when it came to free speech. You know, the only exception, but I wouldn't count them actually as exceptions, is anything to do with inciting to violence, or anything to do with fraud, anything to do with action in order to accept, get values by means of defrauding, by means of violence. Other than that, you should be able to say whatever you want to say on your property. Now, of course, it doesn't mean that you have a right to come onto my property and say whatever you want to say. So I do think private universities, for example, have every right, whether it makes sense, they have every right to decide what is said and what is not said on their university. It is their university. That's the definition. Property rights should be primary in this context. But if you own a radio station, if you own a TV station, if you want to set up a little booth in the corner of your little property and stand up there and yell at the world, you have every right to do so, and nobody should be able to stop you. Free speech should be absolute. And I find it ironic that those who would want to silence, claim to be fighting fascists, right? Isn't the first step that people take when they truly are fascists is to silence their opposition. I don't want to silence anybody. I want us to have a real conversation, and you we're going to disagree. But the idea that you are fighting fascism by silencing people, you then become the fascists.
So I actually have a question. Well, it's not so much a question, it's kind of a comment, because one thing that always annoys me is the kind of literal legalistic reading things. And I agree with you that on, say, a university campus, the university does technically have the right to be able to silence a speaker. But I also think it's important to cultivate the spirit of the thing.
Sure.
Because, even if you can do this, then what you're saying is you would go further if the rules weren't otherwise restricted. And that's something that I think it just speaks to a vastly different mindset.
I mean, I agree with you, and I don't know if we agree on this issue with regard to YouTube. As you know, I think you'd be delisted and come back and gone and come back from YouTube. And I know a lot of people, Jordan Peterson, what's that, something TV, Prager University as being delisted. I mean, put aside whether I agree with them or not, and half the videos from Prager I agree with, and half the videos from Prager I hate. I mean, I literally disagree completely. But YouTube, in my view, and I don't know if we agree on this, in my view, YouTube has every right to decide who should be on and who shouldn't be on it. If YouTube decides they don't want me on, they have every right. It's their platform, it's their technology, they invented it, they made it up. There's no free speech on YouTube. The only entity that can obstruct free speech is the government. So if you don't like YouTube, start an alternative platform. If you don't like YouTube, go somewhere else. The fact that Prager is suing YouTube is, to me, Prager accepting statism and accepting the mixed economy and rejecting his whole supposed philosophy of capitalism. So I completely accept. Now, I can fight YouTube. I can say, hey, you present yourself as a social platform. You're lying to people. But they have a right to do it. It's their platform.
I actually don't agree. I mean, I think the people who are supposed to be protesting this are actually proof that it doesn't just require a government to hinder free speech.
No, this is the difference. If they came in here and protested, if they turned their back on us, or if they booed us periodically, I would say they should be in the room. Absolutely bring them in the room. I want protesters like that, right, who let us speak, but who express the fact that they disagree. What you are not allowed to do is silence the other party, right? So what they are doing is shutting us up. And the job of government, and they're using force to do it, they're using loud voices to do it. What the job of government is to separate us so that we can continue to speak. In the case of YouTube, where they own the platform, it's like the university owning. So as you said before, the university has every right to set its parameters of what is allowed and what isn't allowed. We can say it's inconsistent with the spirit of a university, and I agree with you completely. We can say it's inconsistent with the spirit of YouTube, but you can't sue them. You cannot use them. You can encourage your friends not to use them, but you cannot use the government against them to promote your free speech. Your speech. So we're going to.
Yeah, no, that's interesting. I don't know whether it's going to work. Lawsuit against YouTube.
I don't think it will.
I have no idea.
I'm hoping it doesn't, because I still think the courts in the U.S. respect property rights. So if you come out into my house, I get to decide. If you say something obnoxious, I can kick you out.
Yeah,
and certainly the university has a right, if we say something obnoxious here, they have a right to kick us out. Whether it's right to do so in the context of university, an institution of learning in which there's supposed to be a free exchange of ideas, is a separate question than the proper legal right to decide what is said and what is not said in a private forum. Take this as a private forum, they have every right to do it. I don't oppose them on legal grounds. I oppose them on, hey, this is a university. My ideas are not that nutty. Let's have a discussion if you think so. Let's debate them. Let's discuss the ideas. And I'm open to your ideas. Be open to my ideas. After all, universities shouldn't have free speech zones. Universities should be free speech zones because we're here to learn from one another. The whole point is to expand your mind, to expand your knowledge, to be challenged, to be provoked, not to just accept the status quo. So that would be my argument. Not, hey, it's the First Amendment. No, the fact is I don't have a First Amendment right at Harvard, or I don't know if King's College is a state school or not, but if it was a private school, I don't have a First Amendment at a private school.
I think the difference is that when people are being excessively legalistic, they're not following the principle that they are supposed to be espousing. That's what I'm referring to when I speak about the spirit of it. Because just because you can do something doesn't mean you should do something. Now, this is a good example. Just because you can do something doesn't mean you should do something.
No, I disagree. I think this is great. They disagree with us. They think we're bad guys. And they're making their voices known. Now, if they were in the room not letting us speak, that would be wrong. But they're outside there. I actually think it's great. I think it's right. They really think we're bad people, and they're protesting the fact that we're bad people. I mean, it's sad that they haven't come into the room and actually listened to us and discovered that we're actually really nice and our points of view are not crazy. But if they want to stand there and they want to let the world know that they disagree with what's being said right now, although they have no clue what's being said right now, it's funny. Then it's, they have every right, and I actually think it's a good thing. I mean, I actually think it's good that audiences boo people once in a while, because, you know, just like you clap when somebody says something chewy. If somebody says something you disagree with, boo them. That's okay. You know?
Yeah, I'm totally
as speakers, we have backbones as well.
Well, that's absolutely true, but my point is, like, for example, before we ended up coming in, we had a legalistic argument with the organisers of this event and with the faculty. And they wouldn't let the reason they're so many empty seats is because there are people who have been told that they could come, even though there were students here, and for some reason there was a crossed wire somewhere in the administration, and they weren't allowed in. And it's no real reason to not let them in, other than we have a rule and we're going to make you follow it. And as soon as you start running a society down these sort of highly legalistic lines, then it's not about the principle of the thing, it's not about the spirit of the thing, it's about what you can do and what you can't do. And so there's no reason for someone who wants to do something that isn't necessarily something that should be done, but it is within the boundary of the law, to just do it to you as hard as they can. Because what's stopping you? Why shouldn't they? So this is why I'm against this kind of oppressive legalistic interpretation of absolutely every rule to the nth degree. And I realize that might be controversial, but maybe, just maybe, we can all sit down like adults and have a conversation.
I think you're right, and what's really sad is the fact that in that sense, the protest has won. That is, it's interesting that the rule, we only found out about at least the rule, after the protest was put up their Facebook page. That is, in that sense, it appears, whether this is true or not is a question of fact, but it appears the administration gave into the protesters. That's what the world will see, that's what the protesters will see. And that's sad, because then they now have, you know, they have more incentive to do more of this and more incentive to disrupt more often. Because they won a small victory. That is, there are a bunch of people standing out there in the cold who came from all over London and were not allowed in here, even though originally we were told they wouldn't be allowed to come in.
Yeah, and what a victory it is. I mean, objectivists are some of the most effective people at deconstructing fascism you will ever meet. And then I've spent the last 3 months of my life debating the old right being harassed constantly online by them. Why they would think that we are the people to approach, to protest is beyond me, but at the end of the day, we're the best they've got. They're never going to get the people they actually want to protest on these stages, which is just how...
Because they're too cowardly. The alt-right is too cowardly.
But it's not that the alt-right is too cowardly. The alt-right would beg for a platform. Yeah. The university would never give it.
But it's fascinating. I find it fascinating because I'm constantly attacked by the alt-right online as being this whim, as not realizing the importance of race or whatever. Constantly berated as some kind of lefty by the alt-right. And then the left attacks me as a racist and a fascist. And actually, after this Exeter event, I don't know if you know about the Exeter event that happened, here they go, where some people tried to silence me.
good, actually. Apparently they're going to knock out, they wanted to knock out the security guard.
We'll be back.